Hey, hey. Thanks for coming back to another My Name is Miss Battle. Yes, yes, yes. I just couldn't let the dog distract me like that. I don't want him no more. Do somebody want a dog? Let's give God his glory. Father God, I just thank you because you're God all by yourself. I give you the praise. I give you worship. Oh, Father God, I just bless your holy name, for you are holy. In Jesus' name, I pray, amen, 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 amen. Whatever you do, do it in Jesus' name. I don't care if you're praying, pray it in Jesus' name. If you're talking, talk it in Jesus' name, okay? If you're singing, sing it in Jesus' name. Whatever it is you do, he's saying all things give him the glory. Let's jump to chapter 7. We're in the book of Luke, chapter 7. And it starts off as the centurion servant healed. We're going to jump right on into it. Luke 7 and 1. Now, when he had ended all his sayings in the audience of the people, he entered into Capernaum, and a certain centurion servant who was dear unto him was sick and ready to die. And when he heard of Jesus, he sent unto him the elders of the Jews, beseeching him that he would come and heal his servant. And when they came to Jesus, they besought him instantly, saying that he was worthy for whom he should do this. Excuse me. But the man that's sending us, he's worthy of a healing. He following your law. He doing what's right. That's what they saying. 5. For he loveth our nation, and he has built us a synagogue. Then Jesus went with them. And when he was now not far from the house, the centurion sent a friend to him, saying unto him, Lord, trouble not thyself, for I am not worthy that thou should enter under my roof. And wherefore neither thou, I myself, worthy to come into thee. But say in a word, and my servant shall be healed. For I also am a man set under authority, having under me soldiers. And I said unto one, go, and he goeth, and to another, come, and he cometh, and to my servant, do this, and he doeth it. When Jesus heard these things, he marveled at him, and turned him about, and said unto the people that followed him, I say unto you, I have not found so great faith, no, not in Israel. Because like we all should be saying, Lord, I'm not worthy. And we're not. We are not worthy. We are as filthy rags in the sight of God. We have filthy thoughts. Our heart is filthy. We're not worthy. We're not worthy at all. But you got to say thank you, Lord, for your grace and for your mercy and for your love to save a wretch like me. I'm not worthy. Just speak the word. And not only is we not worthy, but through Jesus Christ, he made us worthy. When he died on the cross, he died so that we can have his righteousness, his salvation. You get it? So we are worthy through him. You're not worthy and on your own. You're not even good on your own. But through Jesus and what he did on the cross, we justified. He died for our justification. Oh, yeah, he will justify you, honey. In the end, you will be justified. Just keep on keeping on. So, that's a lesson. That's a lesson. Because Jesus said, this generation looking for a sign. They looking for wonders. Well, if God do this, I believe he God. And if he give me this, I believe he's God. Ooh, y'all better stop it, stop it, stop it. He gonna be God whether he do it or not. Let's continue. And they that were sent returning to the house found the servant whole that had been sick. See, you're not made whole if you're sick. There's a there's a defect, or however you want to call it, you know, but that makes you not whole. Okay, do I need to read it again? Found the servant whole that had been sick. So, again, that's self-explanatory. You follow Christ, he'll make you a whole person. He will heal you. He will make you. That's his promise. Don't you know he said he promised to be with you always? He promised to answer your prayers if you follow me. Well, not me, but him. Okay? I don't want no glory. I don't have no glory. And I am just a nobody that's trying to tell everybody about somebody whose name is Jesus. Come on, let's read. And it came to pass the day after that he went into a city called Nain. And many of his disciples went with him, and much people. Now, when he came nigh to the gate of the city, behold, there was a dead man carried out, an only son of his mother, and she was a widow, and much people of the city was with her. And when the Lord saw her, he had compassion on her, and said unto her, weep not. And he came and touched the barrier. And they that bore him stood still. And he said, young man, I speak unto thee, arise. And he that was dead sat up and began to speak. And he delivered him to his mother. And there came the fear on all. And they glorified God, saying, that a great prophet is risen up among us. And that God has visited his people. And this rumor of him went forth throughout all of Judea and throughout all the region round about. Don't you know you're supposed to be raising the dead? Mm-hmm. Oh, Miss Battle. Spiritually dead. Don't make me go there. That's our job. To raise the dead, to open the eyes of the blind, that's spiritually blind, that is spiritually dead. If that's what he's saying. That's our due diligence. If we would just be disciples of the word and follow him and make disciples of the word, because you got to know the truth in order to pass on truth. Let's keep reading. And the disciple of John saw him, showed him all these things, or told John. And John was calling unto him two of his disciples, sent them to Jesus, saying, art thou be that should come, or look we for another? See, John in prison right now. John is in prison. Again, we know that they are relatives. But after the baptism, Even John saying he got disciples following him because they got baptized under John's baptism of repentance. So he had followers. And Jesus actually, a couple of John followers started following Jesus. We want to follow the Messiah. We know you made the way, but now the Messiah is here. We wants to go to the Messiah. And so a couple of his disciples started following Jesus. And so John in prison, getting ready to be beheaded. And so he kind of saying, go ask Jesus, he the one? Or should I wait for another? But he know all the time that Jesus is the one. Yes, because he baptized him. He saw the dove land on him. He heard the words of the Lord saying, this is my beloved son. But at a moment, that lets us know right now, we people, we are weak human beings. We are weak. Even though John was full of the Spirit, his flesh was weak. And so now he just need encouragement. I need some encouragement. Somebody coming. Jesus need to encourage me. That's basically what he's saying. Let me know that I'm on the right track. I'm still doing the right thing. That I continue to do the right thing. He already knew he was the Savior. Let's continue. When the men were come unto him, they said, John the Baptist has sent us unto thee, saying, Art thou he that should come, or look we for another? And in that same hour he cured many of the infirmities and the plagues and evil spirits, and unto many that were blind he gave sight. Y'all hear that? Infirmities. He cured their infirmities. He cured their plagues. He cured their evil spirits that was within him, within them. 22. Then Jesus answered and said unto him, Go your way and tell John what things ye have seen and heard. How the blind can see, the lame can walk, the lepers are cleansed, the deaf can hear, the dead is risen. To the poor the gospel is preached. And blessed is he whosoever shall not be offended in me. And when the messenger of John were departed, he began to speak unto the people concerning John. What went ye out into the wilderness to see? A reed shaken with the wind? But what went ye out for to see? A man clothed in soft raiment? Nice clothes? That's what he's saying, soft raiment. Behold, they which are gorgeously appareled and live delicately are in king's courts. But what went ye out to see? A prophet? Yea, I say unto you, and much more than a prophet. This is he of whom it is written, Behold, I sent my messenger before thy face, which shall prepare the way before thee. For I say unto you, among those that are born of woman, there is not a greater prophet than John the Baptist. But he that is least in the kingdom of God is greater than he. Read it for yourself. Wow. Thank you, Lord. And all the people that heard him and the publicans justified God, being baptized with the baptism of John. But the Pharisees and the lawyers rejected the counsel of God against themselves, being not baptized of him. And the Lord said, Whereunto then shall I liken the men of this generation? And to what are they like? They are like unto the children sitting in the marketplace, and calling one to another, and saying, We have piped unto you, and ye have not danced. We have mourned to you, and ye have not wept. For John the Baptist came neither eating nor drinking wine, and ye say he had the devil? The Son of Man is coming eating and drinking, and ye say, Behold, a gluttonous man, a wine bibber, a friend of the publicans and the sinners. But wisdom is justified of all of her children. Mm-hmm. Wisdom is justified. That's why he uses the lowly instead of the wise. That's the glory of God when you can see a person from a very humble state and you see them grow in wisdom and in intelligence, and they're not going to school for it. You just see people grow. You do. In Christ. That's wisdom. That's the wisdom of God that justify why God for him to get the glory. See, he probably won't get the glory out of people that's already in king's houses, presidents and all of these people that dress all fine. That's what the word say, with all they fine apparel. He won't get the glory out of that. But he will get the glory if he takes somebody from rags to riches. Shut your mouth, Miss Battle. Yes, he will. Let's continue. And one of the Pharisees desired him that he would eat with him. And he went into the Pharisee's house and sat down to meat. And behold, a woman in the city, which was a sinner, when she knew that Jesus sat at meat at the Pharisee's house, brought an alabaster jar box of ointment, and stood at his feet behind him, weeping, and began to wash his feet with tears, and did wipe them with the hairs of her head, and kissed his feet, and anointed them with the anointment. Now when the Pharisees which had bidden him saw it, he spake within himself, saying, this man, if he was a prophet, would have known who and what manner of woman that is that touches him, for she is a sinner. So he couldn't be a prophet, because if he did, he'll know she a sinner. Oh, but ain't she weeping and wiping his feet with her tears, looking for salvation, and gets it, and is mentioned throughout the Bible. Ain't that glory of God? And Jesus answered and said unto him, Simon, I have somewhat to say unto thee. And he said, Master, say, there's a certain creditor who had two debtors, and one owed 500 pence, and the other 50 pence. And when they had nothing to pay, he frankly forgave them both. Tell me, therefore, which of them will love him the most? And Simon answered and said, I suppose that he to whom he forgave the most. And he said unto him, thou hast rightly said. Thou hast rightly judged. It's the one that, and because he forgave her all of her sins, she loved him the most. Look at us. We ought to be loving on God, because we are not the Jews. We are the Gentiles that should be loving him the most. And he turned to the woman and said unto Simon, seest thou this woman? I entered into thy house. Thou givest me no water for my feet, but she has washed my feet with tears and wiped them with her hair of her head. Thou givest me no kiss, but this woman, since the time I came in, has not ceased to kiss my feet. My head with oil thou didst not anoint, but this woman has anointed my feet with oil. And wherefore I say unto thee, her sins, which are many, are forgiven, for she loved much. But to whom little is forgiven, the same loveth little. And he said unto her, thy sins are forgiven. And they that sat at meat with him began to say with them themselves, who is this that forgives sin also? And he said to the woman, thy faith hath saved thee. Go in peace. Her faith is what saved her, because she said, if I can just get to Jesus, if I can just anoint his feet, yeah, faith. We walk by faith, chapter 9. And it came to pass afterwards that he went throughout every city and village, preaching and showing the glad tidings of the kingdom of God. And the 12 were with him. And certain women which had been healed of evil spirits and infirmities, Mary called Magdalene, out of whom went 7 demons, and Joanna, the wife of Cusa, Herod's steward, and Susanna, and many others, which ministered unto him of their substance. Of their substance. Okay, ladies, that's the ministry. Oh boy, let's talk about this ministry. Women have a job in the body of Christ. You do, all through the Bible. They preach. I mean, they teach, because they just don't pastor. You cannot be head of a church. You can't be the senior pastor and the pastor wife. And the thing is, there is but and this ministry people are talking about, the ministry women have is a prophetic ministry. Throughout the Bible, that is what it is. I'm calling it like I see it. It's a prophetic ministry, okay? Not a pulpit ministry. Let's keep going. There's other ministries in the body of Christ that women do. They do. Like, have Bible class in their homes. Women, you can do that. That's where your ministry is at. You know, at home. Have prayer meeting in your house. help people that need help. That's your ministry. And when much people were to gather together and were come to him out of every city, he spake by a parable. A sower went out to sow seeds, and as he sowed, some fell by the wayside, and it was trodden down, and the fowls of the air devoured it. Some fell upon rocks. As soon as it was sprung up, it withered away because it had lacked moisture. Some fell among thorns, and the thorns sprang up with it and choked it. And others fell on good ground and sprang up and bare fruit 100-fold. And when he had said these things, he cried, "He that has ears to hear, let him hear." And his disciples asked him, saying, "What might this parable be?" And he said, "Unto you it is given to know the mysteries of the kingdom of God, but to others in parables, that seeing they might not see, and hearing they might not understand." Now, the parable is this: the seed is the word of God. Those by the wayside, or they that heard the word, then cometh the devil and taketh away the word out of their hearts, lest they should believe and be saved. Soon as they heard the word and started feeling it in their heart, here come the devil saying, "Now you know." Take the word right away. Did he really say this? And then they that on the rock. Wait a minute. They on the rock, the seeds that's on the rock, or they which when they heard, they received the word with joy. And these have no root. For a while they believed, and in the time of temptation, they fall away. Soon as temptation comes, tempted to get out here, tempted to be in the world, tempted to do this, tempted to walk in lust, tempted to walk in lying, tempted to walk in this and that. I ain't gonna keep on naming. Because you know what? I know I talk about the homosexual, the liars, and the thief. Let's talk about the envy, the strife that people have, jealousy. We're gonna start talking about that a lot now. Let's continue. And that which fell among the thorns, or they which, when they have heard, go forth and are choked with the cares and the riches and the pleasures of this life, and bring no fruit to perfection. But that on the good ground are they which in an honest and a good heart. Within an honest and a good heart. You got to have an honest heart, people. You really do. So many deceitful and jealous people out here. They don't want to see you with nothing. Having heard the word, kept the word, and bring forth fruit with patience. That's fruit of the Spirit, patience. Yeah, we got to pray for patience. That patience. People are so impatient nowadays. They can't wait on nothing. I don't want to wait in line. I don't want to wait at the light. I don't want to wait on you to finish talking. I just don't want to wait. Let's finish. No man, when he has lit a candle, covered it with a vessel, or put it under a bed, but set it on the candlestick, that they which enter in may see the light. I already told you in the last video, you know we the light of the world. You know, we walk in darkness, and we expose darkness. Darkness can't live in the light, can't strive in the light. For nothing is secret that shall not be made manifest, neither anything hid that shall not be known and come abroad. You think you got secrets? Those secrets gonna be exposed. Yes, they is. That's what the word say. Everything that's done in secret will be abroad. Okay? You have no secret. If you think you got secrets and you want to hold on to your secrets, you're going to take them secrets. I'm taking these secrets to the grave with me. Ain't nobody going to ever. They will be exposed. Just keep living. They'll be exposed. For nothing in secret that shall not be made manifest, neither anything hid that shall not be known and come abroad. Take heed, therefore, how ye hear, for whatsoever has he shall be given, and whosoever has not, from him shall be taken, even that which he seemeth to have. Okay? So, if you're fruit of the Spirit, that's what he's talking about. If you're not producing, if you a tree, and then you're not producing, you're no good to the kingdom of God. That's simple as that. You know, you will be hewed down, the Bible say, because you're not producing. Yeah, if whatever gift you have, you ought to be producing in that. You ought to be growing in that. You got to be. You ought to be, because the more you enter the Word of God, the more you grow. Ain't no doubt about it. God, it got hot. See, I don't know about these, Lord. Help me with these headbands and things. Help me. You got to grow. You got to grow. Let's continue. Then came to him his mother and his brother and could not come at him for the press. And it was told him by certain which said, thy mother and thy brother standeth out without, desiring to see thee. And he answered and said unto them, my mother and my brother are these which hear the word of God and do it. Do not leave that scripture out. He said that hear the word of God and do it. Because if you're just hearing it, you're no good for the kingdom of God. You're no good. Somebody got to say it. You got to be a doer of the word. Show love. Show kindness. Don't get tired of doing good. That's scripture. We haven't read it yet, but we will. Do not get tired of doing good. I don't care how it look. It look like don't nobody appreciate you. Don't stop. It look like because you're doing good. You look like I'm just being walked all over. They just using me. They're not using you. You're doing your godly duty by doing good. I don't care what it look like. If they think they're using you, but you are doing what you know you're supposed to do. Do not get tired. Do not get weary in doing good. Please don't keep going. Keep going. Let's continue. My mother and my brother are these which hear the word of God and do it. Now, it came to pass on a certain day that he went into a ship with his disciples, and he said unto them, let us go over into the other side of the lake. And they launched forth, but as they sailed, he fell asleep. And there came a storm. There came down a storm of wind on the lake, and they were filled with water and was in jeopardy. And they came to him and woke him and said, Master, Master, we perish. And then he arose and rebuked the wind and the raging of the waters, and they ceased. And there was a calm. And he said unto them, where's your faith? How you gonna get excited? I'm Jesus. I'm walked on water, and now you excited, and I'm on your boat. The Savior is on your boat. The Savior is in your life. How you gonna get terrified? How you gonna be afraid? How you gonna be wary? The Savior is in your boat. Let's keep moving. And they, being afraid, wondered, saying one to another, what manner of man is this? For he commanded even the winds and the water, and they obey. Discipleship is learning. See, they're learning. Jesus, that's why Jesus said, you don't understand yet? You don't understand yet? You little faith, this is this. You can't do this without that. They're learning. He's teaching his disciples. And they arrived at the country of the Gergesenes, which is over against Galilee. And when he had come forth to the land, there met him out of the city a certain man, which had devils long time, and were no clothes, neither abode in any house, but in tombs. And when he saw Jesus, he cried out and fell down before him, and with a loud voice said, what have I to do with thee, Jesus, thou Son of God, the Most High, I beseech thee, torment me not. That's the devil, that's the demons talking. Torment me not, for he has commanded the unclean spirit to come out of the man. For oftentimes it had caught him, and he was kept bound with chains and fetters, and he brake the bands and was driven of the devil into the wilderness. They are strong. Demons are strong, and I'm so glad. Now, let me finish this. And Jesus asked him, saying, what is thy name? And he said, Legion, because many devils were entered into him. And they besought him that he would not command them to go out into the deep. And there was there a herd of many swine feeding on the mountain. And they besought him that he would suffer them to enter into them. And he suffered them. Then went the devils out of the man and entered into the swine. And the herd ran violently down a steep place into the lake and were choked. And when they that fed them saw what had done, they fled and went and told it in the city and in the country. And then they went out to see what was done and came to Jesus and found the man out of whom the devils were departed, sitting at the feet of Jesus, departed, clothed in his right mind. And they was afraid. They also which saw it told them by what means he that was possessed of the devil was healed. And then the whole multitude of the country of Gadareans around about besought him to depart from them, for they were taken with great fear. And he went up into the ship and returned back again. Now the man out of whom the devils were departed besought him that he might be with him. But Jesus sent him away, saying, return to thy own house and show how great things God has done unto thee. And he went his way and published throughout the whole city how great things Jesus had done unto him. We ought to be doing that same thing. We ought to be praising God, telling people what God has done for you, what God has done for me. I'm still standing. I am still standing, and I'm in my right mind. Okay? That's a beautiful thing. That's a walk in my shoes. Uh-huh. See, we like to judge people. We ain't never walked in their shoes. We ain't never walked in their shoes. But yeah. Yeah. I like to see somebody walk a mile in my shoes, in my struggles, throughout the years. Yeah. I thank God. I thank God for the strength I have. Because let the truth be told, a lot of people wouldn't be able to do it. A lot of people wouldn't be able to do it. I'm telling you what I know. They're not willing to suffer. They're just not. They're not willing to suffer. You know, they're just not willing to do anything that's going to make them hurt. Yeah, make them hurt. They're not willing to give up no food if they hungry. You know, if they feel like they hungry, they got to go steal, rob, and kill somebody. You know, they're not willing to be homeless because God is still providing, because you still have. You may say I'm homeless. You're not homeless because you got an address. It might not be yours, but God has provided a shelter over your head. That is what he's provided. He provided you with the right mind. He gives you shelter somewhere so you can calm your mind and come to yourself. Let's come to ourselves. Yes. And what I want to say about this, and this was the story I was talking about where the revelation came. God gave me that revelation on this. Because I've said it in another book. It'll say 2,000. I think it was about 2,000 swine pigs. It gives a number, but Luke didn't give the number. But the thing, it just said many. But here's the thing. When in the other book, when you read it for yourself, because you will, read it in the gospel, Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John. I'm sure John would say it again. But with a number. But the thing is, here's the revelation, because I just say, wow, out of one person, did they have 2,000, because it was a 2,000, like I said, another book gives you the number. I was like, they had like 2,000 demons. I believe this. And I'm not the only one. I know it. I know I'm not. You might never admit it, but you thought like that too for a minute until you got revelation. Because I was like, that one person had that many demons, 2,000 demons within. And now, you know, we say they don't come by themselves. We know that. We know that because the Bible say they go get seven others that's worse than them and they come back to the same person. Okay. So, we do know that they don't come alone. But now, as far as 2,000, here's the revelation. And it's, you know what, it's a simple revelation. And once you get the revelation, you'll be like, that was pretty simple. But it didn't dawn on me yet until God gave me that revelation. It's not that it was 2,000 demons in that person. It was the power of them demons to make 2,000 pigs run down the steep hill. It's the power. So don't think, and we know when people are not in their right mind, you can call it what you want to, but when they're not in their right mind, even on drugs or whatever, and they not in their right mind, they gain strength. Don't you know that? They gain strength. It's hard to tackle a person in their right mind. And y'all have seen it. Everybody has seen it sometime, somewhere in your life where it takes five or six people to hold a man down or more. It's the power of the demon. They have power. So look at it like that. It wasn't 2,000 demons. It was the demons that he had enough power for 2,000 herds of pigs. That's what the revelation is, okay? Okay, let's continue. And it came to pass that when Jesus was returned, the people gladly received him, for they were all waiting for him. And behold, there came a man named Jairus, and he was a ruler of the synagogue. And he fell down at Jesus' feet and besought him that he would come into his house. For he had one only daughter, about 12 years of age, and she lay dying. But as he went, the people thronged him. And a woman having an issue of blood for 12 years, which had spent all her living upon physicians, neither could be healed of any, came behind him and touched the border of his garment, and immediately her issue of blood stanched. And Jesus said, "Who touched me?" When all denied, Peter and they that were with him said, "Master, the multitude throng thee and press thee, and sayest thou, who touched me?" And Jesus said, "Somebody touched me. For I perceive that virtue is gone out of me." And when the woman saw that she was not healed, she came trembling and fell down before him. She declared unto him before all the people for what cause she had touched him, and how she was healed immediately. And he said unto her, "Daughter, be of good cheer. Be of good comfort. Thy faith has made thee whole. Go in peace." Oh, here we go again. "Thy faith has made thee whole." Ask God to start with, if you need healing, ask God to make you whole. Mm-hmm. Ask him to make you whole. He will. He will. Because you're not whole if you're sick. You're not whole. You're not whole. Whatever sickness is, whether it's a mental sickness, a physical sickness, whatever ailment it is, you are not whole. Not once did I just read it. I read it twice. So it is what it is. Let's continue. Don't take my word. Read it for yourself. And while he yet spoke, there came one from the ruler of the synagogue's house, saying to him, "Thy daughter is dead. Trouble not the master." But when Jesus heard it, he answered him, saying, "Fear not, believe only, and she shall be made whole." And when he had came into the house, he suffered no man to go in, save Peter, James, and John, and the father and the mother of the maiden. And all wept and bewailed her. But he said, "Weep not, she's not dead, but sleepeth." And they laughed him to scorn, knowing that she was dead. And he put them all out and took her by the hand and called, saying, "Maid, arise." And her spirit came again, and she arose straightway, and he commanded to give her meat. And her parents were astonished, but he charged them that they should tell no man what was done. Then he called his 12 disciples together and gave them power and authority over all devils and to cure diseases. And he sent them to preach the kingdom of God and heal the sick. And he said unto them, "Take nothing for your journey, neither staff nor scrip, neither bread, neither money, neither have 2 coats apiece. And whatsoever house ye enter into, there abide, and thence depart. And whosoever will not receive you when ye go out of the city, shake off the very dust from your feet for the testimony against them." And they departed and went through the towns, preaching the gospel and healing everywhere. If people don't want to hear you, it's okay. It's all right. It's all right. They ain't got to hear you. They ain't got to hear you. Do this. See you later. Deuces. Deuce. Now, Herod the Tetrarch heard of all that was done by him, and he was perplexed because that it was said of some that John was risen from the dead, and some that Elijah had appeared, and to others that one of the old prophets is risen again. And Herod said, "John, have I beheaded? But who is this, of whom I hear such things? And he desired to see him." And the apostles, when they were returned, told him all that they had done. And he took them and went aside privately into a desert place belonging to the city called Bethesda. And the people, when they knew it, followed him. And he received them and spake unto them of the kingdom of God and healed them that had need of healing. I want to stop real quick because the apostles had the power. The apostle had the authority to do what Jesus equipped them to do, to heal the sick, to do the miracles. Those 12 apostles were able because they had the authority from God himself gave them authority. Mm-hmm. Don't you know you have authority now? You have authority to cast out demons. You have authority to heal the sick. You have the authority, you just don't believe it. That's why it ain't working. Let's keep moving. And when the day had begun to wear away, then came the 12 and said unto him, "Send the multitude away, that they go into the town and country round about and lodge and get victuals, for we are here in a desert place." But he said unto them, "Give ye them to eat." And they said, "We have no more but 5 loaves and 2 fish, except we should go and buy meat for all these people." For they were about 5,000 men. And he said unto his disciples, "Make them sit down by 50s in a company." And they did so and made them sit down. And then he took the 5 loaves and the 2 fish. And looking up to heaven, he blessed them and brake and gave it to the disciples to set before the multitude. And they did eat and were all filled and was taken up a fragment, taken up of fragments that remained of them 12 baskets. This is the same one that Matthew was talking about, story of the 12 baskets, because Hey, you got 12 disciples. You done fed everybody. Now go take this home and feed your family. That's how I see it. And it came to pass, as he was alone praying, his disciples were with him, and he asked them, saying, "Whom say people that I am?" And they answered, saying, "John the Baptist. Some say Elijah. Others say that one of the old prophets has risen again." And he said unto them, "But whom say ye that I am?" And Peter answered and said, "The Christ of God." And he straightway charged them and commanded them to tell no man that thing, saying, "The Son of Man must suffer many things, and be rejected of the elders and the chief priests and the scribes, and be slain, and be raised the third day." And he said unto them all, "If any man will come after me, let him deny himself, take up his cross daily, and follow me." Take up our cross daily. Whatever that thing is that's getting you down, pick yourself up and give it to the Lord. He said, "Come boldly to the throne of grace." Whatever it is, whatever that sin, that iniquity, whatever it may be, jealousy, pride, you envying somebody, you covetousness, you want what somebody else got, lay that at Jesus' feet. Lay that down. Let's continue. "For whosoever will save his life shall lose it. But whosoever will lose his life for my sake, the same shall save it. For what is a man advantage if he gain the whole world and lose himself or be cast away?" Oh, boy, boy, boy. Now, once saved, always saved. "For what is a man advantage if he gain the whole world and lose himself or be cast away? For whosoever shall be ashamed of me and my words, of him shall the Son of Man be ashamed when he shall come into his own glory in his Father's house and of the holy angels. But I tell you the truth, there be some standing here which shall not taste of death till they see the kingdom of God." I don't want no misunderstanding about what I say. Again, my mouth ain't no Bible. It's for you to dig deep, read it for yourself, ask God to give you understanding. Because the thing is, once saved, always saved. And how can you turn? Because he said, how can you taste God, taste and see that the Lord is good, and then turn away? You already know God is God, but then you walk away by disobedience. Don't you know disobedient have to be judged? That's because he's a fair God. So it's the disobedience. If we walking away from God, we know God, but and we know truth. We know what he's saying. Don't steal, don't kill, don't be jealous. Honor thy mother and father. We know this. Remember the Sabbath day and keep it holy. But we choose not to because it's okay. I can do my own thing. You have turned your back on God. So don't think that you, while your back is turned on God, that's your choice. So once you make the choice to turn your back on God, you better hope you don't die while you're doing it, because your destiny, your destination, that's the reason why we are to be quick to repent. "Lord, I'm sorry. Whatever it is I did," we do. Be quick. Don't go to sleep. Don't go to sleep without asking the Lord to forgive you. And if it's somebody you got ought against, you go to that brother, that sister. Clear that mess up. I don't want no misunderstanding. I'm quick to clear stuff up because I know I'm misunderstood. I'm misunderstood to the highest point of misunderstood them. Okay? I know this. My name is Miss Battle. That's a battle I struggle with, you know, people misunderstanding me. But it's okay. It's all right. It's going to be all right. Let's keep going. The point is, when you disobey, you are turning your back on God. Period. Point blank. Somebody got to tell you. And please be quick to repent. because we all want to be there, but without repentance, you're not going. You're not going. Simple as that. That's the gospel. The gospel is repent. That's the gospel John was preaching. That's the gospel Jesus preaching. And it's the gospel that I'm reading. Repent fast, in a hurry. Make it right with God. Okay. For whosoever shall be ashamed of me and my words, of him shall the Son of Man be ashamed when he shall come into his own glory and in his Father's house and of the holy angels. But I tell you the truth, there be some here standing here which shall not taste death till they see the kingdom of God. And it came to pass about 8 days after these, saying, he took Peter, James, and John, and went up into the mountain to pray. And as he prayed, the fashion of his countenance was altered, and his raiment was white and glistering. That means his countenance, his face shone, illuminated. And behold, there talked with him two men, which was Moses and Elijah, who appeared in glory and spake of his decease, which he should accomplish at Jerusalem. So this is the Mount Transfiguration where the three, Peter, James, and John, they watch him and they see Jesus illuminate, and then they see Moses and they see Elijah, and then here come Peter. But Peter and they that were with him were heavy with sleep. And when they awake, they saw his glory and the two men that stood with him. And it came to pass as they departed from him, Peter said unto Jesus, Master, it is good for us to be here. And let us make three tabernacles, one for thee, one for Moses, and one for Elijah. Not knowing what he said, while he thus spake, there came a cloud and overshadowed them. And they feared as they entered into the cloud. And there came a voice out of the cloud saying, this is my beloved son, hear him. And when the voice was passed, Jesus was found alone. And they kept it close and told no man in those days any of those things which they seen. And it came to pass that on the next day, when they would come down from the hill, much people met him. And behold, a man of the company cried out, saying, Master, I beseech thee, look upon my son, for he is my only child. And lo, a spirit taketh him, and he suddenly crieth out, and it tears him, that he foam again, he foaming at the mouth again, and bruising him hardly, departed from him. And I besought thy disciples to cast him out, and they could not. And Jesus answered and said, O faithless and perverse generation, how long shall I be with you and suffer you? Bring thy son hither. And as he was yet to coming, the devil threw him down and tore him. And Jesus rebuked the unclean spirit and healed the child and delivered him again to his father. And they were all amazed at the mighty power of God. But while they wondered, everyone at all things which Jesus did, he said unto his disciples, let these sayings sink down into your ears. For the Son of Man shall be delivered into the hands of men. But they understood not this saying, and it was hid from them, that they perceived it not. And they feared to ask him of that saying. And then there arose a reasoning among them, which of them should be the greatest. And Jesus, perceiving the thought of their heart, took a child and set him by him, and said unto them, whosoever shall receive this child in my name receiveth me. And whosoever receiveth me receiveth him that sent me, which is God sent Jesus. So whosoever shall receive me, receive him that sent me. For he that is least among you all, the same shall be great. And John answered and said, Master, we saw one casting out devils in thy name, and we forbid him, because he followed not us. And Jesus said unto him, forbid him not, for he that is not against us is for us. And it came to pass, when the time was come that he should be received up, he steadfastly set his face to go to Jerusalem, and sent messengers before him, before his face. And they went and entered into the village of Samaria to make ready for him. And they did not receive him, because his face was as though he would go. And they did not receive him, because his face was as though he would go to Jerusalem. And when his disciples came, and when his disciples James and John saw this, they said, "Lord, wilt thou that we command fire to come down from heaven and consume them, even as Elijah did?" But he turned and rebuked them and said, "You know not what manner of spirit ye are of. For the Son of Man is not coming to destroy men's lives, but to save them." And they went to another village. And it came to pass, as they went in the way, a certain man said unto him, "Lord, I will follow thee wheresoever thou goest." And Jesus said unto him, "Foxes have holes, birds of the air have a nest, but the Son of Man hath nowhere to lay his head." And he said unto another, "Follow me." But he said, "Lord, suffer me first to go and bury my father." And Jesus said to him, "Let the dead bury their dead, but go thou and preach the kingdom of God." Spiritually dead, he's talking about. And another also said, "Lord, I will follow thee, but let me go first and bid them farewell which are at my house." And Jesus said unto him, "No man having his hand to the plow and looking back is fit for the kingdom of God." Amen, amen, amen. No man that puts his hand to the plow and looks back is fit for the kingdom of God. You better quit looking back. You're not fit for the kingdom of God if you're dwelling in your past. You're not fit. You got to let that go. Do not look back. I know I gave this example a while ago in one of the videos. If you cutting your yard, your lawnmower, you mowing, and you looking back and you mowing, and when you turn around, you're going to see all kinds of ziggity-zag lines. You out of line. You out of line. Same thing. That. Look at it like that. If you looking back, you're going to fall off. You're going to be off track. You're going to get off track. You're going to get off track. Because that's what the past do. It gets you off track. It mess with your head. It mess with your mind, okay? It mess with your heart. Looking back, wishing and wondering, if I had done this, if I had done that. The good old days. I wish we had those good old days. I wish those good old days was back. Quit it. Looking back. You're not fit for the kingdom of God if you keep looking back. Look forward. Because God wants you to look forward. Most holy and everlasting Father, God, I just thank you. I thank you. We thank you, Lord. Yes, Lord. Oh, God, we thank you. Help us, Lord. Help us, Father, just not to look back. Help us, Father, to go forward, to move forward. Help us, Father, to open up our heart for understanding. Please, Father, open up our ears for understanding, that we may hear what the Spirit is saying. Oh, God, I just praise you right now. I praise you right now. And Father God, I ask to give everybody that watches this video, Father God, give them a special blessing. Give them, touch their hearts, touch their minds, show them the right way. Oh, Father God, give them understanding. Yes, Lord. Yes, Lord. Yes and amen. Your answer should be yes and amen. I receive your word. I receive your truth. Help us to walk in your truth. Help us to be doers of your word, not just hearers. Oh, Lord, I thank you. I thank you. I thank you. I thank you. You are a mighty God, a mighty God we serve. There is no other. There is no other. Oh, Father God, I thank you. In Jesus' name, I pray. Amen, amen, and amen. Yes, you have a blessed day. Have a blessed day.